Live from the Lexus Field Terrace at Foreman Field at SB Ballard Stadium, Monarch Media presents Minnie University Football Media. Hi, everybody. This is Ted Alexander along with Andy Mashaw. Andy, we've been waiting for this moment for quite a while. It's summertime outside, but it's football on the inside.
You feel it. You can smell it. You can smell it in the air. The weather just takes a little bit of a dip. You get some rain, and the football players come back out on the field, man. You can feel it. It's coming.
And all the fog and all that stuff.
Let's put it out there, shall we? That's what it is. This is the last shot they're going to have. That's their team rule. The team motto this year is one team, one goal, one last shot. And that's what it is for them. They got one more shot in FCS. The reason they stay in FCS and push the transition year back is so their seniors this year could have a shot at that national championship. They know it. That's their goal. It's a high bar, it's pressure, but that's what they're aiming at.
Coach Bobby Wilder's always said, aim high when it comes to the ODU University football program. They're aiming as high as possible this year. We'll talk more about 2012 in just a couple of moments, but hey, how about a ride in year number three last year? 10-3 overall. A trip to the playoffs in just their third year. The winningest startup program ever. It was an incredible season a year ago. Here's some pictures to refresh your memory.
One song only. So I ball so hard, m****s wanna find me. But first, gotta find me. What's 50 grand to a m****a like me? Can you please remind me? Ball so hard, this shit craze. Y'all don't know that, don't phase. And as we go, 0 for 82 when I look at you like you the gravy. Ball so hard, where? We ain't even Popey here. Ball so hard since we here. Sony
snap to DeMarco. The handoff. Inside the five. Spinning and scoring. It's Colby Goodwin. Touchdown, Old Dominion.
Six. Ball so hard, got a broke clock. Rollies that don't tick tock. All the Mars that's losing time. Hitting behind all these big rocks. Ball so hard, I'm shocked too. I'm supposed to be locked up too. You escape, but I escape. You be in Paris, get messed up too. Ball so hard, let's get faded. Lobberies for like 6 days. Gold bottles.
The snap gets into it. Punt blocked by Old Dominion University. Who's going to pick it up? It's Pickard, and he scores. Touchdown, Old Dominion.
PK. Ball so hard, brothers want to find me.
That's great.
Heineke calls for the shotgun snap, takes it. Now he's looking left, steps up in the pocket, has lots of room. Taylor Heineke fakes. Is he going to make it his first touchdown? Yes, he does. Touchdown, Old Dominion. Taylor Heineke.
Have it all.
So
that's crack. Ain't it Jay?
So
what she order?
What she order?
Fish fillet.
So
yo, whip so cold. This whole thing.
So
act like you ever be around like this again. Who's your girl? Grab her hand. That bitch don't wanna dance. She's my friends, but I'm in France. I'm just saying, Prince Williams ain't do it right if you ask me. Cause I was him, I would've
married Kate and Ashley.
Was Gucci my was Louis my killer? Was drugs my dealer? What's that jacket, Margiela? Doctors say I'm the illest, cause I'm suffering from realness. Got my doctors in Paris, and they going gorillas, huh?
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's not. It's
gets
gross.
The people going.
Also, guys wanna find me.
As Mayer standing behind him, Harper to his right, fumbles the ball to Heineke, trying to buy himself some time, rolls to the far side. Again, Fran targeted like Heineke, throws it up for grabs toward the end zone. That ball is going to be, is that caught by the end zone?
Caught
it, Old Dominion! Whoa, what a catch! Snap good, hold good, kick is going to be way short, and Old Dominion's going to beat James Madison by a final count of of 23-20. The biggest game in the history of the program goes to the Monarchs.
That feeling you are now watching the throne. Don't let me into my zone. Don't let me into my zone. I'm definitely in my zone.
Ball on the 5-yard line. Harper, the running back behind Heinicke, he'll take the handoff. Angus takes it off to the far side. Angus Harper, touchdown, Old Dominion! Answer the Tribes go-ahead touchdown. Reverse. Here comes Vaughn. He's going to throw it. He's got a man, Reed Evans. Can he hit Evans? Evans, touchdown from Antonio Vaughn. The option pass works for six. As the Monarchs have won the first ever battle of Silver Masons, they will take that base back to Norfolk, where it will rest until next year's game between Old Dominion and William and Mary.
Field of 20 here that will compete for the Division I football championship, and you can see in the lower bracket, Old Dominion and Norfolk State.
Okay, both teams welcome to the postseason to be their first FCS appearance for both schools.
ODU is an incredible story. After 69 years of no program, it came back in 2009, and here they are into this tournament.
Historical day today, Jay. First time that two schools from the same city have met in the postseason in all sports.
Wow.
That's in NCAA postseason history, and they're separated by less than 5 miles.
Four touchdown passes today for Heinicke. He's looking for more right now. Going near side to Gill. Pass caught. Touchdown, Old Dominion. Heinicke to Prentice Gill. His fifth touchdown pass of the day. By Vaughn. First down. Antonio Vaughn is in the clear. Can he get all the way? He's going to be brought down in the end zone. Touchdown, Old Dominion. 48 yards. 26 seconds to go in the half.
They were gambling. They've been doing it the last 3 downs. They brought the safeties on the blitz. Heinicke, he finally caught him.
Dreadful, and I got plenty of bread, so I throw the bag full of lies.
might call you my cousin blood, but we ain't kin. You think of jumping, man, you best think again. The dirty, I'm the type of man that might go broke from revenge. Had some not so nice friends, kick the door off the hinge. Take the door off your bins, pop up my phone and your friends. Man, please, this is very cynical. Nano subliminal, I'm physical, financial, and mental to be a general. Hey, the mama claims she want a soldier. Not the type be in the tank, but in that rover. Man, please, I'm in the zone like AIDS full blown. I'm killing it like a blind man reading. I'm feeling it like, oh, yeah. Here comes the, oh, here comes the, oh, here comes the. That you the type to run and go and tell just by looking at you. You on a mission for recognition by dissing. Didn't have no problem till the record started breaking. But y'all don't really want. So let me tell you the deal. I'm also serious, I'm dirty, I'm no longer for real. I'm like a hop, skip, and a jump. A clock, grip on the pump. From leaving you in the trunk, somewhere prepared to jump. But y'all don't really want it. So quit acting like you're dead. I'm looking to my right, trying to see who's left. So you better watch it before I stick to the plan and be the next artist to run up in your stands. Like, ooh, yeah, here comes the, ooh, here comes the, ooh, here comes the. Y'all don't really want it, yeah, yeah. Here comes the, ooh, here comes the, ooh, here comes the. Y'all don't really want it, yeah, yeah. Here comes the, ooh, here comes the, ooh, here comes the. Y'all don't really want it, yeah, yeah. Here comes the, ooh, here comes the.
Number 10 national ranking, trips to the second round of the playoffs. What a year 2011 was, and the architect of the ODU football team, Bobby Wilder's here. Coach, you just took a look at some of those pictures. That's pretty nice stuff from last year.
Oh, it is. It's exciting to think we're getting ready to go. We've been in camp now for about a week, and players are really excited. But media day and being with you two really signifies the season's here.
He's had this circled on his calendar for a long, long time. A word or a phrase to describe a year ago, the springboard into this year. Talk about 2011.
2011 gave this program confidence. It was such an unknown going into the season. As you guys know, we were number 10 out of 11 teams going into the league last year. We go up in our first league game at Delaware and don't play well. And I think a lot of it had to do with the nervousness of the players. And this was Delaware, and they'd won national championships. And well, then we come home and beat UMass, and all of a sudden there was a confidence level. And then, oh, by the way, Taylor Heinicke steps into the mix. And away we go for a 6-2. So getting that confidence that we can play at this level of football, we can beat nationally ranked teams, we can go to the playoffs, has given the entire program confidence that we can get back to the tournament in 2012.
You're talking about confidence. I mean, the team that played that Delaware team early in the season is a completely different squad than what faced Georgia Southern at the end. And it wasn't all just about a quarterback change. It was just experience and, like you said, just building up confidence. What does that do heading into this season?
Well, it gives everybody a sense that they can play, they can compete at that level. And we bring back 45 players. The and have experience. You know, we've got 18 out of 25 starters back, including our punter, our kicker, and our long snapper, that they've not only played at this level now of football and competition, but had success. So there's a confidence amongst the team. There's also now a sense within the team when they can tell with what level we're practicing at. For example, our third practice was an okay practice, but it wasn't the level we practiced at. And right away, Craig Wilkins and our older guys picked up and said to the players after practice, hey, tomorrow morning, everybody out on the field at 6:30. Practice four is going to be at the level we know how to practice at. So that, as much as anything, has helped us. They know and understand the level now that they have to perform if we're going to get back to the tournament in 2012.
Talk about the theme of this year, one shot, one team, here we go. Last year in the CAA, talk about the mentality that you want your team to practice with and to take to the game.
Yeah, that was really a sudden change, if you will, Ted, when I got the call May 17th and we were up in Northern Virginia doing some fundraising, and Dr. Seale said, come on back, we're going to Conference USA. On that bus ride back, I knew when I got back and we made the formal announcement right over here, I met with the team after, that was going to be a critical meeting in setting the tone for what was going to happen, because you had a bunch of confused young men. You know, what does this mean for this program? You know, they all thought we were going to compete for national championship, and I came up with that theme on the bus ride back and presented it to them, that this was one team, one year, one shot at the national championship. And what I meant by that was, this is our last year at the FCS. You know, we moved to FBS starting in 2013 and really can't compete for anything. So this was our last opportunity at the FCS to compete for the national championship. And I put right on this presentation I made to them, a PowerPoint presentation, that January 5th in Frisco, Texas is where we have to work to get to. That needs to be the goal of the program. Where last year the goal of the program was, you know, let's see if we can get to 7 wins. Let's see if we can get in the conversation for the postseason, and then we go 9-2 and get there. Well, that was all a pleasant surprise. You know, this year the expectation is to get one of the 10 at-large bids, because we know we're not eligible for the CAA championship. We've got to get one of the 10 at-larges, try to get as high a seed as we can, and going in preseason number 8 into this season helps, because to get one of those at-larges, we're going to need to be ranked highly when we get into it. Then we also want to be at home during those playoffs. You know, we were at home for one game last year, which certainly helped us. But we prefer not to go on the road later in the tournament. So those are lofty goals we've set, but that one team, one year, one shot, that's what that's all about, because this is it for Old Dominion football at the FCS level.
Andy, the team averaged 35 points a game last year. The questions came on defense, especially against Georgia Southern. When you see a national powerhouse like those Eagles just cut through that defense and say, boy, we need to make some adjustments, and they have.
Well, yeah, I think a lot of the problems with the defense last year was a lot of injuries. You guys, everybody has injuries, but having injuries in the same position. I mean, this is Nick Mayer's jersey here. He was playing cornerback last year. This is one of your best receivers playing corner. He didn't even force the fumble.
He did.
But I mean, you can't compete at the highest level with your best receivers playing cornerback. This year, you know, obviously everybody's healthy to start with.
Right.
Things are a little bit different. You got a brand new defensive coordinator, a brand new defensive system. Some guys are moving around. I think Alex Avery is going to have a big year if he stays healthy. I love that position for him. But, you know, where does this defense start off at this year?
Well, I've already seen a major change in spring practice. We had 15 practices in the spring where Bill D, a new defensive coordinator, and Keata Malloy, our new assistant defensive coordinator, who both, by the way, were part of the offense last year. Their toughness, their tenacity, they can already see it with our players through those 15 practices in the spring and the 8 we had so far. We had to get back to some basics and really focus on the toughness aspect of tackling. We were not a very good tackling football team last year. You mentioned the injuries. You know, when you've got Nick Mayers playing corner for you against Georgia Southern, and you mentioned caused the fumble, his first team all-conference wide receiver, we were just decimated at some spots last year. Having T.J. Coward back, I think T.J. Coward's up there with D.W. Webb and some of the other top corners in the league. He went down in the second game last year, so he's back. We've got Eric Lewis at the other corner, who was an all-conference performer at the end of the year. We moved Craig Wilkins from an outside linebacker to a middle linebacker, so now he can affect both sides of the football. He can get to both sides of the play quickly. Chris Burnett's preseason All-American. You mentioned Alex Aran, moving him up from linebacker. Alex has really been on a mission.
He's been all to move up.
You know, from wide receiver to safety to linebacker. Now to DN, who's put on 50 pounds since he's been there. His freshman year in 2008, he was part of that original class. He was 180 pounds. Now he's 230. We moved Kai Blanco over from the tight end to a defensive tackle because tight ends don't see a lot of playing time in our spread offense, as you guys have noticed from calling the game. So I think Kai is going to have an impact for us. I feel much better about where we are defensively now than I did at this point last year. And obviously, it's got to translate. We've all got to see it out on the field, but those kids really have an attitude on defense. They're going to like the fact they were 72nd in the nation in scoring defense and 104th in pass defense. They didn't like the fact that everybody felt like, you know, the offense was good enough, the special teams were good enough, the defense just wasn't quite up to par. And, you know, we all know our defense had some really good moments last year. And I think to that shutout against James Madison in the second half, and there were some other quality performances, but just not consistently enough throughout the year when we needed those stops, like the end of the Towson game. It wasn't there. But what a different attitude we have right now, and I'm really excited to see these kids play.
Offensively, of course, the season took an earthquake-like jolt during the UMass game when the bubble wrap was pulled off the true freshman Taylor Heineke. 25 touchdown passes, just one interception. He's just a sophomore now. He's just a freshman, a Cinderella season, so to speak. What does he do for an encore, and how do you keep expectations realistic for him and the rest of his offensive teammates?
Well, the first thing I told Taylor, I said, Taylor, there's a really good chance you're not just going to throw one interception this year.
Really?
It generally happens a little more. We went back, and Coach Wickham does a really good job when he studied it last year. There were five or six that should have been, you know, tip balls and things like that. But what we've asked of Taylor in the offseason, Coach Wickham wanted him to get a little bigger, a little stronger, which he did. He put on about 15 pounds of muscle. Feels like he'll be able to, you know, maybe break an arm tackle here or there, or absorb a hit. That's going to happen a little bit better, so he gets stronger. The second thing is he got much more comfortable within our system. Remember, he went into the fifth game, and here's a guy who in preseason had been on some scout team and getting very few reps at all with the offense, none with the first team. So it was a maturation process throughout the season for him. Well, now he's had all of spring ball. He's had these eight practices so far in preseason. He'll have three more weeks before the first game, and he's starting to get a better understanding of our protection system. He's making checks now, which he wasn't doing last year. He's able to adjust the protection better. He's able to change the play here or there if he needs to. So those are the things, Ted, we're seeing from him. Just that comfort level is much better now than it was last year.
I said learning an offense is kind of like learning a foreign language in mm-hmm. that it, you may be able to know a few phrases,
right,
a couple sentences, but you're not going to be fluent in it until you can learn to think in
right.
that language, until you have to, you just react. You
right.
don't have to think and plan about where this guy's going, who do I have to slide over here, if this guy, he's at that level now. He's getting very
right.
close to that level.
Yeah, that's a good point, Andy. One thing that really helped him was he ran a similar system in high school. So he comes out of high school, and they're running the spread offense in Collins Hill and performing at a high level. This school outside of Atlanta that plays at the highest level of football, a playoff team. There's plenty of college players he's playing with and against. So he was already performing the spread offense at a high level. You're right, the terminology was a little bit different, but the carryover really helped. It wasn't as if he was running the triple or the wing T in high school and he had to come in and learn something brand new, but he's also very intelligent. He studies the game, he spends a lot of time with Coach Wickham studying the game, and that carryover was really big for him coming from high school. We could tell right away last summer that he had a good knowledge of our system when he arrived on campus.
A lot of weapons on that offense beyond number 14. Talk about some of the other guys you're counting on, not only in the skill positions,
right.
but the linemen doing the protecting and the clearing out.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Ted. He does have a lot of good players around him. You start with Nick Mayers, who was first team all-conference wide receiver last year. Nick's been dominant so far in camp. Larry Pinkard, who quietly, if you will, scored 10 touchdowns last year, you know, 9 receiving and 1 off the block punt. Angus Harper scored 10 touchdowns last year. Antonio Vaughn is a redshirt freshman. Excellent season. Blair Robertson, Jaquale Bailey is true freshman last year. Wide receivers were in the mix. So, and then there's a number of other wideouts. I feel like we have 10 wide receivers right now that could all play.
all from Nick Mares all the way down to Kirk Spellman, who redshirted last year, the freshman out of Indian River, Chesapeake, all these guys can play. And that'll allow us to keep going fast. You guys know how we like to play, and if a receiver runs a deep route, he's coming out, the next guy's in, we just go. I mentioned Angus, Colby Goodwin's back healthy, which is big. You know, Colby was hurt a lot last year, and that not only affected our offense, but I've always felt like Kobe's one of the top kick returners in the nation. 2 years ago, we were number seven in the nation when he was healthy. And he got hurt over in Hampton back in 2010 at the end of the year. It's just he's had some unfortunate injuries, but he's going to play a lot. He and Angus will really handle the run game. We'll be a two-headed monster back there, running back. You know, we may list Angus as a starter, but they're going to play. You know, they're going to rotate in. And you mentioned the offensive line, too. Really solid group. The big question was, how do you replace Jeremy Hensley, who's been the only center of the program's known? And we feel like we've done that with Josh Manning. He's really done a nice job through the spring and the preseason. He's getting a lot of confidence up there. Lowney will play left tackle. Bourne will play left guard. And then Robbie Dunn will play right tackle. So we're the same there. Those three guys come back intact. Right guard's a question mark right now. It's a three-man battle between Connor Newborn and DJ Morrell and Brandon Carr for that spot. And you know, whoever takes it, we've got a 6-on-7 in the O-line that helps us. You know, we haven't traditionally been deep in the offensive line, but I feel like we've got 7, 8, maybe even 9 guys in the offensive line now that can play. So there's some depth at all the positions, and Nate Ong's had a good camp backing up Taylor. We've got a couple of really good freshmen at quarterback. So I feel like there's depth all the way across the board from the O-line back to the quarterback, running backs, and receivers now that we haven't had in the past.
I was just thinking, you know, a couple of years ago, you guys were holding your offensive line together with duct tape and chewing gum.
Now it's maybe moving Matt Carrillo from tight end to tackle.
Right. Now you got maybe one of the deepest spots in that offensive line right now. And I mean, these are very good offensive linemen. These guys have been grown up. They've gotten, these are bigger offensive linemen just right off the bat.
Yeah, we're going to average probably 300 across the board, which we've never been that big and still be athletic.
Special teams, before we get you out of here, they've always been special here at Old Dominion. Your all-star teams, once again, loading up for Bear.
Yeah, really excited with the first 8 days of practice, Ted, with the all-star team. When you bring in a new group of players, the first thing we have to do is get the emphasis to them that they understand that the all-star team is where we start. You know, you don't start on offense or defense until you become a starter on the all-star team on special teams. And we've got that emphasis through the first 8. We've got a lot of freshmen involved right now, but it starts with the big three. It starts with Plisco and Brown and Lovato. You know, Rick Lovato was a true freshman last year, perfect on all his snaps for punts and PAT field goal, which is critical. That controls field position, and he allows us to run all the specialty plays, if you will. We don't call them fakes here at Old Dominion.
Specialty plays.
Yeah, because he can snap it, and he can snap it through his legs. He can snap it to the side, either side. So we run some fakes off of punts. We were practicing out here this morning. Jared Brown got off to such a hot start last year. You know, he cooled off towards the end of the year, missed some field goals late, but had the longest field goal in the league last year, that 51-yarder at Georgia State. Was kicking the ball really well on kickoffs. And then our All-American punter, you know, averages 46 yards a punt last year in Plisco. So all three of those guys, the punter, the kicker, and the long snapper, are back. They all had really good years. And that'll allow us to continue to do some specialty things within the special teams that we like to do.
Old Dominion University Football Media Day from the Lexus Field Terrace at Foreman Field at SB Ballard Stadium. Ted Alexander, Andy Mashaw, joined by head football coach Bobby Wilder. Coach, Monarch Nation is out there. Talk to them about expectations and what you expect from them this year.
Well, Monarch Nation, the first thing you need to know is we have two all-stars back right here. Great to have you both back. Appreciate it. Really, what we need from the 12 Monarchs this year, Ted, is to pick up where they left off against Norfolk State. A 19 penalty performance out of the 12 Monarchs. We attributed 13 of those penalties to what we call dead ball penalties, meaning before the ball was snapped, there were penalties on Norfolk State.
It's huge, which is huge.
It is. You talk about going from a 3rd and 5 to a 3rd and 10, which was what was happening a lot. They couldn't get the play snapped on time, or somebody jumped off sides, or they had an illegal substitution simply because they couldn't hear. It was so loud at this facility. There were a couple times I took my headset off because I was trying to gauge, was it louder than William & Mary in 2010
And it was. So the 12 Monarchs really stepped up their game for that playoff game, and I'm hoping they'll come out for the whiteout September 1st against Duquesne and pick up right where they left off. But the expectations I want the 12 Monarchs to have for this team is that we need to go further than we did last year. We're preseason number 2 in the league. We're preseason number 8 in the country. Our goal as a team is to get back to the national championship tournament, hopefully be home for more than one game, and then hopefully end up in Frisco, Texas with you two fine gentlemen on January 5th. Wouldn't that be nice?
That would be wonderful. Frisco. One team, one year, one shot. Head coach Bobby Wilder, thanks for stopping by. Best of luck this year.
Appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Bobby Wilder, head football coach at Old Dominion University. And Andy, you talk about this. One year, one team, one shot. Pressure, but it's a good kind of pressure, I would think, for these guys that want to continue to aim high.
It is pressure because you're looking at almost perfection. I mean, you don't have to have, it's not like FBS, but you got to win every game to have any real contention. If you lose one, you're pretty much done. It's not quite like that, but when your goal is a national championship, that bar is pretty high up there. But these guys know that. You know, I think they're going to be ready for that. They've been, like Coach Wilder was saying, they've been in those situations before. They've been to the playoffs before. They've been in big games before. I think they can handle it.
When you talk about expectations, it has to also help on the recruiting trail. When you're looking for folks that are shooting here rather than here, you're looking for the cream of the cream and the cream of the crop. And when you go into that living room, you can tell that to your families and make them feel right before they even come to the Dominion that that's what's expected.
And every game is going to be like that. There are no soft games in there. I mean, there are no games you can just take a breather. Every game is so important. You have to get in that large bid, but you have to aim at that national championship. You know, there's no plays you can take off.
All right, now enough of the coaches. We want to talk to some of the guys that are going to get the uniforms dirty just a little bit. Grab that microphone. And Reborn. Talk about the mentality going in to this season. I mean, granted, one year, one team, one shot. Kind of pressure.
Yeah, you know, there is a lot of expectations on our program right now. And, you know, but when you prepare and have a good offseason, you put yourself in a great position to make a lot of these expectations come true. You know, this summer we worked out really hard, and I think everyone has really bought in to this year. And, I think this year's going to be pretty good.
What did you tell yourself this summer that you, before you came back to camp, you needed to do to make you a best player?
My off-season focus was getting more fit and just kind of increasing my foot speed and hand strikes. You know, I feel last season my foot speed wasn't as good as I wanted to be, so this offseason I focused more on agility and getting my technique down.
As a unit, this offensive line, I knew it started with Coach Wilder. It's one of the biggest and also the deepest offensive lines they've got. I mean, like this is that right guard spot. You've got three guys who are in the same spot. How does that affect the unit as a whole? You know that you guys have depth, and if something happens, you have somebody that can plug right in beside you, and you don't have to worry about it.
You know, that's a great thing because when you have people competing for spots, it kind of brings out the best in everyone. And, you know, our right guard spot right now is still up for grabs. And you know, when you have depth across the offensive line, it kind of takes a load off your mind. And the fact that, you know, if you go down, you've got someone that's serious that can back you up. But it also, you know, like I said, competition, you know, I know that if I'm not on top of my game, then my spot can't be taken. So it kind of brings out the best in everyone, and we all kind of push each other.
A born offensive lineman out of California. How did you find your way to Old Dominion from California, A and B? Remember, we're beaming out to the Golden State as we speak. Anything you want to say to your peeps out west?
Hey, I just want to say, Mom and Dad, I love you. And, you know, shout out to all my friends in Bakersfield. Love you guys. But how did I come here? Wow. You know, Coach Scott recruits to California junior colleges. And he gave me a call one day, and I talked to him for a little bit. And he talked to me about the program, and I talked to Coach Wilder, and I was very impressed with everything he's doing here. And him and Coach Scott and Coach Wilder came to my house and made a great impression on my parents, and I bought into it, and I love it. It's been a great decision to come here.
Best of luck this year. Expectations high, but I'm sure you wouldn't want them any other way, would you?
Nope. That's it. Just compete.
David Bourne, offensive lineman for Old Dominion University, stopping by on media day, not only to open up those holes, Andy, but also to protect the quarterback. And with this offense, you've got to not just sort of take the snap and be prepared. Like, you're moving all over the place.
Exactly. You think about the pace of this. Like Cook-Walter was saying, they rotate receivers in and out. A guy runs a 40-yard pattern, they'll replace them. They'll take them right back out so they can get that next playoff in a matter of seconds. The offensive line doesn't switch out as much, so those guys have got to be ready to get up, get down the field, get set, a lot of huddle, and know where they're going, and be able to pick up changes on blitzes, pick up changes in protection. It's not an easy spot to do, and have guys who know what they're doing is a very good thing, especially if you're in that quarterback spot.
Cue the guys that know what they're doing. It's redshirt senior Robbie Duncan. Robbie, grab that microphone right there. 1 year, one team, one shot. What's that mean to you?
I'm so glad that, you know, going into my last year, just wanted that one last shot, you know, to get that title shot, and getting that chance now is really exciting.
As you flash back to a year ago, first trip into the playoffs, what was the vibe like in your soul when you're playing here against Norfolk State and on the road at Georgia Southern?
Just, you know, every time you play in the playoffs, I played in playoffs high school too, just it's just more, you know, it's that one, you get that one shot. You know, if you don't execute, you don't do your job right, you know, you could lose that chance. You just gotta get your head right and get ready to play.
We talked about the depth on this offensive line. It seems like you've played just about every position on this line. You've been back and forth, left to right, guard, tackle. Now it seems like you've sort of got yourself a home there. And how does that help you feel a little more comfortable?
It definitely helps. One thing I focused on when I first got here was making sure that I was versatile and I could play anywhere they wanted me. But getting the chance to focus on one position and be, you know, solid at that spot is definitely more secure for me. And now I'm just ready to play hard and help us get that shot.
You have a perspective that not a lot of redshirt senior college football players have in the country. You were here when this thing, before it even kicked off, you were out there practicing with nothing to practice for except a vision. What's the journey been like for you, and how special has it been to create this program or help create this program?
Yeah, it was rough. Like, you know, getting that chance to be part of the first ODU football team, be part of the something brand new, was really exciting to me when I came out of high school. And I walked on and, you know, worked my way into the starting lineup and got the scholarship. And then, you know, since then, just making sure I'm, you know, someone to rely on the offensive line and protect, you know, Taylor and give it up open lanes for Colby and Angus to make big plays and stuff. So I'm just looking forward to really step it up this year.
For those that were wondering from the stands here at SB Ballard Stadium, during the UMass game, when you saw Thomas go down and you saw the bubble wrap coming off that little wet behind his ears fawn, what was going through your mind?
I had, you know, hope. I knew that from hearing about Taylor coming out of high school that he broke all those records and was really good. You know, being a young buck right out of high school, you know, anything could have happened. But thank God it happened the way it did, you know. I mean, it was a real shame that it happened to Thomas, but, you know, that's just the way football is sometimes, you know.
The thing that helps a little bit is that he's, I won't say as mobile as DeMarco, but he is very mobile. He's more of a scrambler than a runner like DeMarco was.
Taylor's deceptive. He's very deceptive. You wouldn't think he is, but when he gets in that open field, he's like a running back out there almost.
How does that help you guys, though, to know that, you know, if a mistake is made or if, you know, somebody gets beat, you know, you have a guy who can help you out, extend the play a little bit?
Well, I never want to make a mistake, you know. But, well, yeah. But if that's the case, then, yeah, it is very helpful to know that he can make plays on the run like that.
The other thing, from an offensive line perspective, how has this offense, especially the chemistry between you guys and Heineke, gone as far as protection goes and changing protections up at the line or, you know, just moving offense?
Communication is the key with that. Like, on the offensive line on the whole is always, you know, communicating, making sure we're all on the same page. But when Taylor changes protections and everything like that, it's, you know, we repeat it, yell it out, and make sure everybody's ready to go for that play.
Robbie Duncan, best of luck this year. Enjoy the redshirt senior season.
Thanks.
and good luck as we head down the road.
All right, thank you.
Robbie Duncan, pride of Sterling, Virginia, the redshirt senior offensive lineman here as Monarch Media Day continues. Andy, 2 weeks from Saturday, we're playing Duquesne right over there. It's going to get crazy.
2 weeks. Is it really 2 weeks?
I think it is. Isn't it 2 weeks? Is it 2 weeks, gentlemen? Everybody here probably knows it's 2 weeks.
It's fine. It came up in a hurry. I mean, you're in the middle of July, and you're thinking, oh, man, it's hot outside, and we got so far to go. And then the next thing you know, 2 weeks later, you have 2 weeks to go. I mean, it just ramps up.
Nick Mayers joins us. Nick, how much time until the first game? 2 weeks. 2 weeks from Saturday. First of all, everything in the CAA is as a wideout. When you're playing ball in Virginia Beach at Lansdowne, did you think you'd be able to translate so well to this level?
Anything's possible with hard work. I'm a hard worker. Coaches around here are the man. They push us to the limit. So I kind of had a feeling, you know, things were going to turn out well, but I couldn't expect it with all the success we've had here so fast.
Into the playoffs a year ago, what was that experience like?
It was great, really. You know, every time we play, it's a great feeling, knowing the amount of support we get from our fans. You know, they travel anywhere. That's one thing you don't have to worry about here. Anywhere you go, we always have that support, and people here cheering you on when you do well.
We talked a little bit about the depth of the offensive line spot, but the deepest position probably on this team is that wide receiver. You guys, it seems like every year in and year out, you're competing against each other as hard as you're competing against anybody else out there. How does that help sharpen you?
It's really good. You know, everybody wants to be the best. It's good having that level of competition between amongst positions. You know, everybody wants to score. Everybody wants to have the most amount of yardage. You know, everybody wants to be selfish in a good way. You know, as long as we help each other win, you know, that's the overall goal.
Led the team with 62 catches a year ago. Nick Mayers joining us. And perhaps the one stat you'd want to point out is that forced fumble against Georgia Southern. What was it like having to put on the defensive jersey because your team needed you?
It was actually an honor, really, that Coach Rada asked me to play defense. You know, anyway, I can help my team, you know, whether it's special teams, you know, kickoff, punt. I don't really care what it is. You know, so him asking me to play defense was really an honor. I was just glad I could help my team out in that situation when I needed me.
There are probably days when having the long hair is wonderful and fashionable and outside the helmet. What about in the heat and the humidity? How do the long locks work in the dead of summer?
They don't work at all. It's very hot. It definitely slows you down when you're trying to run and the wind is on your head doing conditioning and stuff. But, you know, I have a helmet on. As long as they're not grabbing me, trying to tackle me about my hair, you know, it's not really much of a problem.
We look forward to seeing you in action against Duquesne 2 weeks from Saturday. Nick Mayers, congratulations on your career thus far. We look forward to bigger and better things this season.
Thank you.
Nick Mayers, wide receiver, one of the, as Andy mentioned, the most crowded positions of quality. I mean, top to bottom, you're talking quality athletes. The system helps them, but the athlete certainly helps as well.
Coach Wilder said they've got 10 receivers on this team, 10 that can play just about any other team at this league. And it's just incredible how deep it is and how sharp they make each other. But Nick, I got to tell you, he wants the football. No matter where he is, you see him in practice, this guy knows. You guys are doing like Oklahoma one-on-one type drills for running backs behind. But Nick slips in there, tries to take carries from some of the running backs. And you know, he's just one of those guys that wants the ball.
Greg Wilkins wants the opportunity to go out as a senior captain with another trip to the playoffs, et cetera. The only four-time captain that we can think of in all of college football. Greg, welcome. Your thoughts as you head into the last time you're doing this and the last time you're doing that. It's the last time you'll be here at Media Day.
That definitely it came to fruition when we took our senior picture, which I thought wasn't going to take at first, but luckily we took one. It just feel like it happened so fast, but you know, the way everything's been going, everything's happened fast in this program. It's competing in the CAA, it's moving up to Conference USA. Everything's just fast at ODU.
1 year, one team, one shot. You have to sort of be one of the captains that help the young guys understand what that means. What point are you trying to get across?
We're trying to make them realize that like they're not only playing for themselves, this is what they're playing for us, this senior class. The guys who helped this program be what it is at this current point and what it probably will be in the future. Definitely trying to convince them that like they're going to have to play now. So I don't think any of them came in expecting a red shirt. For those who do, they'll enjoy it for 1 year. For those who don't, they have to play on the line this season, not only for themselves, but for the senior class. For the guys who pretty much made everything that's happening right now possible.
We talked about this new defense and how everything switches. You get another new position. It seems like a new position every year for you. It's a good thing you're graduating because they keep moving you closer to the ball. Next year you could be playing nose guard. But at this middle linebacker spot, you got access to the whole field now. I mean, you're closer to the middle, you go left, you go right, you drop back into coverages. How is this new system fitting in for you guys?
It's fitting in very well. Everybody's playing more physical, more tougher, playing more downhill. Something that we didn't do as much last year. We were successful at stopping the run, but now we're more downhill shooting gaps with linebackers, defensive line penetration. Better tackling, definitely. Probably Coach D's favorite word, tackling, because that's all we work on, pre-practice, during practice. It's critiqued all the time, so we're definitely improving both of playing more physical and tackling.
Pardon our ignorance here for a moment, but you see, when you follow football, a lot of people talk about better tackling. You have to learn to tackle better. We aren't tackling well enough. What does that mean, and how do you learn to tackle better?
It's more so from a technique standpoint. Anybody can run, throw themselves into someone and pull them down, but it's more so a technique point. Last year, a lot of missed tackles, guys weren't bringing in feet, bringing in hips. The basic fundamentals that Coach D is trying to teach, you know, coming up through instead of hugging. So that's definitely points that we can work on.
This defense, this year, through spring and the couple of practices that I've seen, it just seems like there's a new pride on this defense. Not that there wasn't, you know, pride last year, but it seems like this year, just from the statistics and the result last year and all the talk that they got last year, everybody doesn't want to see that happen again. Everybody seems to be on the same page. Their defensive backs, number 104 in spring, because that's where their pass defense ranked nationally. And the guy who performed the worst in their last practice had to wear that jersey. Nobody wanted that jersey. And it just amped everybody's performance up. It just seems like this defense now feels like you guys are going to be a strength, not just a weakness anymore. Now you're going to be one of the strong points of this team.
Yeah, that's definitely a point for us in the defense. Nobody wants to be seen as, you know, the bottom feeders of the team and things like that. Myself being the leader of defense, I definitely don't want us to be seen like we're just, you know, hanging on offense coattail, but they're great. I mean, it's hard to live up to as a defense, but we definitely don't want people to see us as just like, oh, we're riding the offense coattail, things like that. Defensively, everything's getting better with the new coach, especially Coach Lloyd. That's probably one of the greatest improvements to our defense, you know. Meetings and things like that with him. He tells you like it is. He tells you straight up. Coach D, they're very honest. They shoot you straight forward. You know, they don't beat around the bush too much. And Coach D also brings excitement and energy to the defense.
Greg Wilkins heading into his final campaign. Thanks for joining us. Best of luck this year. Four-time captain. Before we get you out of here, what's that mean to you?
It definitely means a lot. I mean, it's definitely an honor to possibly be the first four-year captain. I mean, Coach Wilder felt that I was a great enough a leader to lead my team for these 4 years, and I definitely won't let him down this year.
Thanks, Greg. Greg Wilkins, bringing it from the inside linebacker position this year, Andy, what's that mean for the layman? What's that going to do to improve that line?
Well, this new system, this new defense is going to look, probably to the regular guys sitting out in the crowd, they're going to look at it, they know football at all, they're going to look at it and say, oh, that looks like a 3-4, which it kind of is and it kind of isn't.
Well, thank you, Andy, for the specifics on that particular question.
The defensive end spots aren't going to be your typical four linemen hand on the ground defensive end. Alex Lane is probably most of the time not going to have a hand on the ground. He'll be rushing a stand-up spot from that outside. Occasionally, he'll drop back into man spot, man coverages, which is something they didn't do a whole lot. Coach D is going to put in some man coverage, straight man, not necessarily one deep or a single high safety. It's going to be straight man on a couple of occasions. A lot, but every once in a while. And it's just different looks. Guys rushing from different angles, different spots, different stunts. And like Craig was saying, linebackers just slide right in behind him and putting him closer to the middle, gets him closer to the ball, which helps him. But it also opens up, because if he's playing on the outside, he's only got one half of the field that he's really concerned with. Now in the middle, he's free to roam the bat a little more and get into more plays.
That's from the defensive angle. What about offense? Let's go back to that side of the ball and bring in quarterback Taylor Heinicke, who is back for his sophomore season, a true sophomore. A year ago, he was one of the wide-eyed guys here at Foreman Field, just wandering through media day, wondering what was going on, talking to a couple of people, hoping for his shot. The shot came, and he certainly took advantage. Happy media day, starting quarterback. What a difference a year makes, huh, Taylor?
Absolutely. I didn't know what to expect today. Last year, I was home by now, sleeping on a nap, so I'm happy to be here.
The one team, one shots, the one opportunity. What's that mean to you?
It means everything. You know, seniors who founded this program, they deserve everything from everybody right now. This offseason will be good, but emphasis on, you know, seniors deserve this. We should be all in for these guys. So team's bought into it. It's doing really well.
As off-season conditioning, look at him, it's bigger.
He looks bigger.
He is bigger, and he's also faster. I know the strength and conditioning program here is top-notch. I mean, how has that helped you? Does it give you more confidence to be able to take a few extra shots?
Absolutely. Last year, I got up some hits, and I just didn't know where I was a couple times, and I saw some stars. So this year, I tried to put on at least 10, 15 pounds. That's what I did. I'm up to 195, 200 now, so hopefully those hits don't hurt as much. And break some tackles, maybe. So that was a huge emphasis this offseason.
I know a lot of people are saying, okay, 25-1, what do you do for an encore? How are you a better player now than you were a year ago?
Last year, if you watch film in the early part of my season, you can see I was very sloppy. I didn't know a lot of my reads, a lot of my footwork was bad. So that was a huge emphasis this offseason. Also, keep my footwork down, actually knowing the offense more. I only knew about 50-65% last year. I feel like I know up to 90-100% this year. So it looks a lot more open this year.
What is it like to be out there with the place going nuts? You're at the controls, the offense clicking, and you're just zipping up and down the field.
It's awesome. You feel on top of the world when the score touchdowns, the crowd goes crazy. It's awesome. I credit all my everything, the coaches, receivers, and the linemen. They make everything happen. So I credit everything to them.
I think the question most people are going to be thinking out there is, all right, last year, one interception, like Ted said, 25 touchdowns, one interception. The biggest enemy you may face this year may be your own head. And getting it in there, I know the coaches have said they've put it into you. There will be an interception throw. At some point, there will be an interception throw, whether it's a tipped ball or a long route or miscommunication or something. It will happen.
Absolutely.
So how they work with you to try to, so you don't have to worry about that as much. Let it go.
Yeah. Well, last year, if you watch film, there's about five or six times where there should have been an interception. It should have been about 25-6, 25-7. So that portion of my mind, I'm scared to throw a pick is out. We've got our fair share of picks this offseason, during the spring and summer. Defense looks great. So once I throw an interception during the season, it just off my shoulder. It really doesn't matter as much.
How do you learn to handle all the attention?
Coaches, they really mold you into what you need to say and how to deal with everything. So,
do you like it? Is it a pain in the neck? Is it up and down here and there? A little bit of everything?
Yeah, a little bit of everything. Sometimes you like it, sometimes you just want to be left alone. So, during the season, you like it. You kind of want the spotlight, but in the off season, you just want to kind of be off to yourself. So, I'm off and on.
Well, we only have 45 more minutes with you, so. Taylor Heinicke, sophomore quarterback, thanks for stopping by. Best of luck. 2 weeks from Saturday, it's all for keeps out there.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Very good. Taylor Heinicke. And again, who would have known, Andy? The whole plan was, all right, well, they're gonna redshirt this guy from the Atlanta suburbs, and all will be rosy down the road. But then the UMass Minutemen came in, and it was time for the debut. And what a debut it was, and the season was epic.
It really was. I remember that game specifically, seeing the team come out of the locker room at halftime and watching Heinicke sitting there throwing balls on the sideline. I'm like, wait a minute, why is Heinicke warming up on the sidelines? And sure enough, man, it just went downhill from there in a hurry. I mean, it just took off. The speed of this offense, everything just amped up, and it continued on through the year, and it's going to continue on to be even faster now in the offseason. Everybody's getting more familiar with this thing and getting more and more reps in. I think the speed of this offense, not just during the plays, but in between plays.
The speed of this offense is going to be so incredibly fast. It's going to catch a lot of people off guard. I may have a chance to say two or three words in between each play. Won't be much analysis going on because they're going to be running another play.
Well, the interesting thing about this is the fact that and you brought it up and the coaches brought it up, so much more of the playbook, so much more of a familiarity with the system, et cetera, and the rest of his teammates. That's how he can get better. And you can build upon the 25-1. And the great thing about Taylor we've seen right throughout the whole thing is the fact that he knows 25-1 is crazy. Mm-hmm. He knows that, and he also knows where his bread's buttered with the offensive line and the receivers pulling him out of jams at times. The fact that he came in with that kind of humility last year ingratiated himself to the rest of his teammates, and therefore the transition from the senior leader DeMarco out with the injury to the who's this guy from Atlanta getting all the props Heinicke went very smoothly.
It really did, very smoothly, and it helps the maturity level that Heinicke has is very impressive for a guy who came in who's a freshman. He was playing high school football last year, and now he's playing 20,000 people in the middle of the playoffs. And he handled it really well. And it, the maturity level, the confidence that his teammates had in him to not make terrible decisions, to make quick throws, it just ran so smoothly that you could not have planned it any better.
All right, 10-3, number 10 ranking a year ago. Time to turn the page to 2012, 2 weeks from Saturday. It's Duquesne right out there.
Let's spend just about a minute or so talking about this 2012 schedule. Monarchs picked second in the CAA, and
therefore, with this one last year and the goal on January 5th in Frisco, Texas, or February 5th, the championship game, what do we think about this season?
Well, other teams know Old Dominion's goal, too. They all know that this is their last shot. They all know that they're going for a national championship, and they know that they're leaving for the FBS. Every game this year is going to be, you might as well rename this team the Old Dominion Circles, because every team is going to have a circle around their game with Old Dominion. They're gunning for them, especially the CAA. They think, oh, you think you're better than us? Well, here, watch this. We're going to come after you. We're going to come after you hard. Every week is going to be like that. So this bar set so high is not going to be easy to do, but again, I think this team has the preparation and the mindset to be able to do it.
Duquesne here in Norfolk, then a trip across the HRBT to Hampton University, then Campbell, and that's the non-conference schedule, if you will. Then it gets into the CAA, and Andy, for anybody that was up at that CAA media day, there was a little angst in that room as Old Dominion came in 1 year, stole everything, got into the playoffs, finished second after being picked for 10th, and then the next year they come in and say, hey, this is our swan song, everybody have a very nice day. Now, the present from the CAA was, okay, you have your nice day, but you aren't going to win the championship of our league. Rhode Island's leaving also, but you can win the thing. So that created some problems. There's going to be a lot of emotion on this field during the CAA games. Not only that, you add the quality of the league in terms of football, and this is going to be a crazy year.
There are teams that were kind of had off years or down years last year that aren't going to have those this year. I mean, if you want to say JMU had a down year last year, they still got into the playoffs, but they weren't as strong as people thought they were going to be in conference. This year, they will be different. That defense is still there. They've got a FBS transfer quarterback who may, you know, get their starting spot. Tell you what, man, that last game going into Bridgeforth Stadium, that place, that will be like the Super Bowl for this conference. It'll be right down to the wire. That place is going to be loud. It is going to be hostile, maybe the most hostile environment they've ever played in. And a lot of it is going to be like that all year long. Every CAA team is going to give them your best shot. Even the bottom dwellers in the CAA are going to give them your best shot because they want to send a message. You're not as better than us as you think you are.
You ready?
I'm ready. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go out there. I'm going to grab this helmet.
You grab this helmet, lace them up. Well, that will do it for our coverage of Old Dominion University Football Monarch Media Day for 2012. 2 weeks from Saturday, we're up and running. We want to remind you that the first Bobby Wilder Coaches Show will be on ESPN Radio 94.1 on Monday nights, August the 27th, and then the following Saturday we begin right here. Our pregame show will be once again from Kauffman Mall, the Toyota pregame show, and then we'll come on over here, and for the 6 o'clock kickoff, it's going to be crazy because football is back. For Andy Mashaw, all the Monarchs, this is Ted Alexander. Thank you for watching this Monarch Media presentation of ODU Football Media Day.